Hey everyone, in this video I'm going to do a statistical genetics tutorial using genome-wide association studies, and specifically I'm going to go over how you can calculate the genetic correlation between two genome-wide association studies. And we're going to use the results from two studies. The results of genome-wide association studies that are made public are usually called summary statistic files. So we're going to take the summary statistic files that are publicly available from two separate genome-wide association studies, and we're going to calculate the genetic correlation between these two studies in Python using a program called LDSC. LDSC stands for LD score, which is a type of regression. So it stands for linkage disequilibrium score regression. And this is something that you can do in statistical genetics. By definition, the genetic correlation, which is usually written R underscore G, stands for the correlation of phenotypic effects by genetic variance across a genome on two phenotypes. So that's the definition that Google gave me. It basically means that if you have a genome-wide association study on two separate phenotypes, if the genetic correlation between those two studies is high, that means that the genetic variance that explains each phenotype is shared across those two phenotypes. Phenotypes with similar underlying genetic causes will have high genetic correlation. Phenotypes that have different underlying genetic causes will have low genetic correlation. So in the first part of the video, I'm going to go over a little bit how you can set up your Python environment in order to run the code. And then in the second part of the video, I'm going to go over the code of how you can take genome-wide association study results and then use that to calculate a genetic correlation between two studies. So I'm going to put the link to everything in the description box below, but we're going to use this program LDSC. It has instructions at the bottom of how you can install and then use LDSC. So I already did this in my local Mac laptop, so I'm going to go over some things and then just discuss some things. So when I open a terminal window, I already have Anaconda that allows me to create different Python environments. When you start Anaconda, you're going to start in the base environment. And basically what LDSC wants you to do is to create a Python environment that's going to have all the different packages or modules that it wants you to use. So to do that, it's going to tell you to git clone the code, and it's going to create a folder called LDSC when you run that in the terminal. And then it's going to tell you to create an environment using Anaconda, using a YAML file that it provides you. So you're going to download it in the first step. And I have already done that. So I already have an LDSC folder. I created a genetic correlation folder to put in all my results. Then I downloaded LDSC, the software that has a YAML file that has the environment information. The main thing that you're going to want to do, so when I try to follow these instructions are a bit out of date. The main thing is that this code runs on Python 2.7 and not Python 3. If you try to run this code today, because today the default is Python 3 point whatever, you're going to get errors because there's differences between Python 2.7 code and Python 3 code. That's the main thing. It's written on an old format of Python, and then it just has some dependencies that it will load in for you. For me to get this Python environment created successfully, what I had to do was I first had to create in Anaconda a Python environment that was in 2.7. So the default is going to be 3. So I first had to create a Python environment in 2.7, be inside that environment, and then when I loaded in the environment file, then I was able to create the appropriate Python environment. If you run that code successfully, it's going to create a Python environment called LDSC. So just to show you guys my Python environments or Anaconda environments, I'm going to write conda info dash dash environments. That's going to show me the list of environments that I have. So as you can see, I first created a Python 2.7 environment, and then from within that environment I then ran this code that was given to us, and that created the LDSC environment. To create the Python 2.7 environment, I'll put a link to this as well. I just ran this line of code. So I'm not going to run it in this tutorial because I already have these environments created, so it's going to give me an error if I try to run the code because it's going to say that these environments already exist. But this will create a Python 2.7 environment in Anaconda, and then from within that environment, if you run the line of code that will create the LDSC environment, it should run successfully. For me, since I already have these Python environments correctly created, all I have to do is conda activate and then pass in the name of the conda environment, which is LDSC, and that will put me in the correct environment to actually run my code to do the pre-processing and the processing of the genome-wide association studies. Code-wise, there are two main steps for calculating a genetic correlation between two genome-wide association studies. The first step is you're going to do what's called munging the data, which is basically a way of cleaning up the data. The data are the summary statistics files. So we want to standardize these files to make sure that we can get the same statistics across multiple files that were possibly saved in slightly different ways. And that standardization process and cleanup pre-processing is called munging. There is code for that in LDSC, and I will put the code that I use in the description box below as well. After the raw data has been munged, you're going to have two cleaned files, summary statistics files, and then there's going to be just one line of code for actually calculating the genetic correlation using these two summary statistics files. So the data that I'm going to use for this video is publicly available. I'm going to get it from the Psychiatric Genomics Consortium. So if you go to that website and then go to For Researchers, download results, you will then be able to find the summary statistics files that are publicly available for multiple different genome-wide association studies. And the phenotype for these different studies is given here in this column. So you could run genetic correlation across any of these phenotypes. So we have eating disorders, MDD, schizophrenia, etc. And it gives you a link to the actual journal article as well as the summary statistics files that you can use and download for your own research. In this video, I'm going to calculate the genetic correlation between major depressive disorder, which is known as MDD, and panic disorder. So, in my genetics correlation folder, I have a folder called SumStats, which has the raw data already downloaded. So, this is the major depressive disorder summary statistics file that I downloaded from this website, and this is the panic disorder results that I downloaded. So, these are the raw data, and first, what we're going to do is we're going to munge both of these files.
So I have the code for how to munge both of my files here. And the main thing is we're going to pass in the Python code that we already downloaded and that is in our LDSC folder. So this munge sumstats command needs a couple of options that you have to pass in. So we're going to pass in the name of the summary statistics file. So first I passed in MDD, which is the summary statistics file for major depressive disorder. And the main thing that it needs for munging is a couple of the column names are going to differ between summary statistics files. And so you have to pass in the name of the columns for it to be able to accurately standardize across different summary statistics files. So the way I did that was I just opened the file. So if I open the MDD summary statistics file, I need to know what some of these column names are. So when you open the summary statistics file, you'll see the column names at the top. And so these might differ slightly from file to file, and that's why you have to pass them in to munge some stats. So for example, the results for each SNP, sometimes they are given as beta coefficients, or sometimes they're given as odds ratios. So you have to tell munge some stats if the column is OR or if the column is beta. And so in this case, the MDD results are given in terms of odds ratios. So we're going to pass in the value OR for odds ratios. An odds ratio is significant if it differs from 1. So we put in OR comma 1. If it was beta, beta is significant if it's different from 0. So if the results were given as beta coefficients instead of odds ratios, you would pass in the term beta comma 0. So there are basically two options there. It needs to know the name of the SNPs. In this case, the column is called SNP. It needs to know the frequencies for allele 1 and allele 2. P is for p-value. And then you have different options. So sometimes there will be different number of cases and controls. So that's how it is for my study. So in this case, there's a NCA column for the number of cases and NCO column for the number of controls. If you want to know what all your options are, in the terminal, you can do munge sumstats dash h, and that will give you the help. The help will give you all the options for munge sumstats. So let me cd into my LDS folder, and I'm going to do dash h. And when that finishes running, it gives you all the different options that you can pass in to Munch some stats. So if you don't have the individual number for cases and controls, then you can just pass the overall sample size that you think your GWAS study was. And it has different options. Some of these are required, some of these are not. And you would use that for each individual summary statistics file that you have. So we have those options. For merge alleles, you're going to need to pass in another file. So for each population that you're working with in your genome-wide association study, there's going to be an underlying racial group, and different racial groups come from different places in the world, and so they have different underlying LD scores. And so usually when you run a genome-wide association study, you need to know your base population, and you need to have basically a list of the base SNPs for that racial group. In this case, I'm going to be working with European population, and so we need to pass in a folder that has the base population genetic information. So this is a file that's called UR_W_LD_CHR. It's mentioned in the tutorial, but I think the link to that data is wrong. So let me see where it is. It's going to mention that you need LD scores for whatever your population is. And in this case, it says you can get it from the 1000 Genomes Project. So I'll put a link in the description box below for where I got the data. So there is the data publicly available. This is, again, just an example for the European population. But you're going to need to have this data on your computer. So in this case, I have an inputs folder. In the inputs folder, I have this folder downloaded. And so this is the reference that you're going to use in your code. And that's given in this line here. So merge alleles, and then you pass in your base population folder or information. In this case, it needs a SNP list. And then in the last line of code is the option for where you want to output your results. So the output is going to be a cleaned summary statistics file. For my folders, I have summary statistics, and then I have a folder called munged. So munged is going to be the clean data. And this is the output folder that I'm going to pass into my code. I have already done this, so I think what I'm going to do is I'm going to delete the output that I have so I can run it on video. So I already have my raw data and I have the code already set to go. So I'm going to munge the summary statistics of MDD first. That code took just a minute to run, and it gives you some information about whether the munging was successful or if it failed. And if it failed, it will give you information for what went wrong so you can fix your code. In my case, the code ran successfully. And if I check my munged folder, I now have the cleaned MDD summary statistics file. So I'm just going to go ahead and do the same thing for the panic disorder genome-wide association study. And that took a minute to run as well. So the munging step is important because if you look at the optional parameters that I put in for the second file, the column names were different from one summary statistics file to the other. So in this case, the SNP column was called ID. In this case, the signed sum stats were beta instead of odds ratios. The number of cases and controls had a different column name as well. And so this is information that gets standardized in this munge sum stats step. So once we have our munged data, we are now ready to calculate the genetic correlation between these two summary statistics files. So we're going to calculate the genetic correlation between panic disorder and major depressive disorder in the European population. So to do that, we're going to use this line of code that I have here. So we're going to use a Python code called LDSC. We want the genetic correlation between our two munged stem stat files. So we're going to pass in an RG, which stands for genetic correlation, between panic munged, comma, and then the second file, MDD munged. We're again going to use the base or reference population of Europeans. So we're just going to pass in the entire folder in this case to ref LDCHR and WLDCHR. And we want the output to be called MDD_panic. So I created another folder in my genetic correlation folder called genetic correlation. So sometimes you are running this genetic correlation code for many studies. And so I just put the output basically in an output folder. So my output folder is called RG. I'm going to go ahead and delete this since I already created it. And that will just be my output folder. So I'm going to run this line of code. That code ran successfully and it only took 11 seconds to calculate, and it gives the output in the output folder as well as printing it to the terminal window. So the genetic correlation between major depressive disorder and panic disorder is given here. It is equal to 0.3815. And it gives you the p-value and the z-score as well for that genetic correlation. So that is a statistically significant, I would say there's definitely some correlation between panic disorder and major depressive disorder, although it's also clearly two different disorders as well. So it's maybe a mild to moderate correlation between those two disorders according to the genetic correlation. And if I look at that output folder, it gives me a log file that has all the information formatted nicely. So it has some extra information. It has the genetic covariance and heritability of phenotype 1 and 2. So that is pretty much it. The last thing I wanted to show in the video is that I was curious if I had, just as a sanity check, if this value seemed reasonable. So what I did was I actually checked the paper. This is the Genome-Wide Association study paper for panic disorder. So this is where I got the data from. And actually when I checked the paper, they did calculate a genetic correlation between panic disorder and MDD. So I was curious if my results would be the same or similar to their results. I think I couldn't confirm what exact data set that they used. So I think it was slightly different than my data set. Let's see if I can find the genetic correlation. Oh, here it is. In the genetic correlation analysis, an experiment-wide significant genetic correlation with panic disorder was found for major depressive disorder, and it gives the genetic correlation RG as 0.431. So again, I think they used a slightly different data set. I don't think the data set was exactly the same as mine, but it was probably similar. And I do feel like the 0.3815 is very similar to 0.431. And so this was just a sanity check to me that I did the genetic correlation correctly. And that's all I wanted to show in this video. And thank you guys for watching.